وذكر فإن الذكرى تنفع المؤمنين.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والعاقبة للمتقين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. سأصرف عن آياتي الذين يتكبرون في الأرض بغير الحق، وإن يروا كل آية لا يؤمنوا بها، وإن يروا سبيل الرشد لا يتخذوه سبيلا، وإن يروا سبيل الغي يتخذوه سبيلا، ذلك بأنهم كذبوا بآياتنا وكانوا عنها غافلين. والذين كذبوا بآياتنا ولقاء الآخرة حبطت أعمالهم، هل يجزون إلا ما كانوا يعملون؟ وقال عز وجل: لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: كل أمتي يدخلون الجنة إلا من أبى. قيل: ومن أبى؟ قال: من أطاعني دخل الجنة، ومن عصاني فقد أبى. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام، رواه البخاري رحمه الله تعالى. وعن أنس رضي الله تعالى عنه قال: قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: من أحب سنتي فقد أحبني، ومن أحبني كان معي في الجنة. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام، رواه الترمذي رحمه الله تعالى. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال: قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: من تمسك بسنتي عند فساد أمتي فله أجر 100 شهيد. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام، رواه البيهقي رحمهم الله تعالى. صدق الله وصدق رسوله النبي الأمي الكريم، ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم ربنا زدنا علما يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. Respected and honorable علماء الكرام, مشايخ العظام, honorable قراء, respected حفاظ, أئمة الكرام, leaders, elders of our community, colleagues, friends, young children in Islam, honorable mothers and sisters listening at home, I would like to greet you with the beautiful greetings of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It is only the grace and fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has enabled us to sit in the gathering of the God-fearing whom we just experienced a few minutes ago. The words, the kind words, the Hazrat Maulana Shaykhul Hadith, Peer Murshid, Hazrat Maulana Abdul Rauf Sahab, Daamat Barakatum Al-Aliya, are words of encouragement for this useless slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are not worthy of the praise given by Shaykh, but it is only through the fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His grace, and the du'as of our parents and our elders, that He gives us the ability to say a few words which can be maybe a means of our success, inshallah, in this world and the hereafter, inshallah. I thank from the deepest of my heart Hazrat Shaykh for giving those few humble words of encouragement to try and get the maximum attention of the listeners. This was Shaykh's firasat. That Shaykh mentioned this for our benefits. It's for all of our benefits. Shaykh mentioned these things, so it's a means of me as well. Allah save me, because this position is very delicate. Allah protect me from the evils of my heart, inshallah. Allah protect me from the evils of my tongue, inshallah. Because to sit here and then maybe have this feeling, a'udhu billahi min dhalik, that somewhat we are more pious or virtuous, and the listeners, is a very delicate and a dangerous thing. May Allah save me from rujul and kibr and pride and arrogance, ameen ya rabbal alameen, and may He make us all the true and sincere slaves of Himself, ameen ya rabbal alameen. First time that I have been blessed of visiting masjid for a program. Alhamdulillah, I was honored a few months ago to visit Alhamdulillah this masjid to meet our Sheikh, local scholar, Sheikh Mufti Yusuf Sajasa Dawud Barakatum Al Ali. Alhamdulillah, I think he lives nearby, or we went to somebody's house nearby to meet Sheikh. So Alhamdulillah, I was blessed. And when the brothers invited me, extended the invitation to me, I wasn't aware that this is the masjid that I actually visited before for that purpose. But Alhamdulillah, once again, Allah has brought me here to try to the best of my ability to share some words from the Quran and Sunnah. I beseech Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that give me the tawfiq and the ability, whatever time Allah ta'ala destines for me today, to say what is haq, inshaAllah, and may He save me from what is evil. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. بڑی خوشی کی بات یہ بھی ہے کہ الحمدللہ ہمارے کافی عمر رسیدہ حضرات کی یہاں پہ تشریف فرما ہے. آپ حضرات کا احسان ہے کہ الحمدللہ آپ لوگوں نے آج کے اس مخصوص مسجد کے پروگرام میں رونق بخشی ہے. اس لیے کہ خصوصی طور پہ شاید یہ پروگرام نوجوانوں کے لیے رکھا گیا, لیکن آپ کی شرکت کی وجہ سے ہمت افزائی ہو جاتی ہے. الحمدللہ کچھ نہ کچھ انشاءاللہ ہمیں دین کے سلسلے میں کچھ کام کی باتیں انشاءاللہ مل ہی جائے گی انشاءاللہ. آپ حضرات کا میں ممنون اور مشکور ہوں کہ آپ حضرات بھی اس پروگرام میں شریک رہیں, اور گاہے گاہے انشاءاللہ اللہ اگر مجھے توفیق دے گا تو کچھ نہ کچھ باتیں اردو میں بھی عرض کروں گا انشاءاللہ, اگر اجازت ہو. خصوصی پروگرام تو جوانوں کا ہے, اس لیے انشاءاللہ انگریزی میں خاص خطاب ہوگا. اس کے علاوہ اگر اللہ نے توفیق کی ہمت دی تو کچھ الفاظ انشاءاللہ اردو میں بھی عرض کر دیے جائیں گے. The situation that we are living in today is a life of challenges. The circumstances around us are circumstances which are taking us away from the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The forces around us are the forces and the army of Shaitan and Iblis. These forces are trying to take us and to make us from their group, from the Hizb al-Shaitan, from the group of the Shaitan. But these challenges, these forces can be overcome by us if we follow the true guidance of Allah and His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is something not impossible, brothers and sisters. These challenges were here. These challenges are here. They will remain until the day of judgment. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said in his time, "Badiru bil a'mal salihah." Hasten towards righteous deeds. Nek a'mal ko jaldi jaldi karo. بادروا بالاعمال الصالحه فتكون فتن. فتنے آئیں گے, there will be many fitnas, turbulence and mischief that you will face on the face of this earth. بادروا بالاعمال الصالحه فتكون فتن كقطع الليل المظلم. They will come in succession, they will come one after the other. These fitnas, these trials, these tribulations will come onto us in a way like the dark portions of the night. As it goes more darker, we need more light. As Qiyamah will come nearer, the fitnas will increase. Allah protect us, inshallah. Allah protect us, ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. These fitnas, these turbulence will be increasing in the number. فَتَكُونُ فِتْنَ كَقِطَعِ اللَّيْلِ الْمُظْلِمِ. Rasulullah says, يُصْبِحُ الرَّجُلُ مُؤْمِنًا وَيُمْسِي كَافِرًا وَيُمْسِي مُؤْمِنًا وَيُصْبِحُ كَافِرًا يَبِيعُ دِينَهُ بِعَرَضٍ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ رَوَاهُ التِّرْمِذِيُّ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ. That this person, there will be a person who in the morning will be a believer of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But night time will come and he will come into the fall of Islam, to go away from the fall of Islam. Allah protect us, ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. There will be fitna to such an extent that a person's iman will be gone overnight. Allah protect us. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. And there will be a rat chase. There will be a rat race for wealth. People will want to accumulate wealth, whichever means or way it might come. Min al halal or min al haram. May it be halal means or haram means. Maal aana chahiye, paisa aana chahiye. Achhi zindagi guzarne ke liye halal tareeke ikhtiyar karke agar insaan ko sukoon mil jata hai to ye to noorun ala noor hai. Ye milna bhi koi mushkil nahi hai, lekin haram tareeke se. Quick rich. A person wants to become quick rich. You see youngster day, he's just graduated, he's just finished his studies. Suddenly you see a change in their life. They suddenly have so much wealth that they can't understand where it's coming from. Is it from halal or is it from haram? That is the question the person needs to pose to themselves. How come our elders, they earn and they work. Eventually, they got to a stage where they could buy a mansion. They got to a stage where they could buy something which is of leisure and pleasure. But how come a youngster today, suddenly he is getting wealth from means we don't know? Maybe he is doing from halal, alhamdulillah. But if it's from haram, Abdullah Abdul Rahman, Fatima Zainab, then we need to pose a question to ourselves. Am I getting the real peace of mind? Am I getting the real enjoyment? Am I getting what I want? Because this might be temporary measure. This might be temporary pleasure. This is falsification of our pleasures and leisure. This is just a thing which desire, which looks nice and glitter towards us. But eventually, when the punch blow will come, when reality will kick that person, when he'll come back to his senses, then he will realize, oh, what's happened? Where am I going? Where am I supposed to go? Allah. Yeah. This is the world we're living in today. The situation is everybody wants to see a lifestyle of leisure and pleasure. حب الدنيا رأس كل خطيئة. The world's the love of the world is the root of all sin. Allah Rahman. This world is here for us. It's a necessity. It's a need. We use it. The example I normally give to my students is that when we build a house, and when we build a house, we'll also build a toilet. Because that is a need, a necessity of our daily life. We need to go to the toilet to answer the call of nature. Yes or no? Yeah? Because if we don't go, then there are problems within our system. Yeah? So we need to answer the call of nature. So we're going to build a toilet. If a person doesn't build a toilet, they put the best of mansions, and you go to their house and say, Zara mujhe istinja ka taqaza hai. Intezar kare zara. 10 minutes ke baad inshallah hum aapko le jayenge. Why is that? After 10 minutes? We don't have facility of a toilet in our home because it's something, it goes to the sewers, and we don't have something that goes to the sewers. Actually, yeah? We don't have a toilet. It's something that we don't have. If you really go, you can go 10 minutes away to a certain, you know, public toilet, and we can make use the public toilet. This guy's insane, man. He's built a mansion, yeah? He's built a mansion. He's not built a toilet. If a masjid is built, and we don't build the toilets, again, it's going to be something which is a necessity and a need of the musalliyans that come to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the same way, this dunya, Allah has given us this dunya. And this dunya, Allah says, the Prophet says in his blessing words, إِنَّمَا الدُّنْيَا خُلِقَتْ لَكُمْ. This world has been created for your benefit. Is dunya ko paida kiya gaya tumhari khidmat ke liye. Lekin tumhe kiske liye paida kiya gaya? Wa antum khuliqtum lil akhirah. You have been created for the hereafter, inshallah. Yeah? This world is going to be there. All the luxuries will be there. Not to say that I am belittling or they don't misquote me. There's nothing wrong in having riches. La ma'asa min ghina. And Bipak's Gospel says there's nothing wrong in having riches. There's nothing wrong in having a nice car. A nice BMW or the convertible, you know? Yeah? or the big cars, or nowadays you get the small cars, the big wheels, yeah? So whichever one you want to have, as long as you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As long as you show gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't have arrogance. Because this is what is the problem. In today's society, everybody wants to feel, I am more superior to the other. I am more better than the other. I am more luxurious than the other. I am better off than Abdullah living down the street. I have more possession. I have more wealth than the other person has. I have more izzah. I have more honor than the other person has. I am a person of a status which the other one doesn't have. This is the core problem of our society. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَأَصْرِفُ عَنْ آيَاتِيَ الَّذِينَ يَتَكَبَّرُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ. Allah says, sometimes Allah uses the terminology of when He's speaking Himself. Allah sometimes uses the plural tense. Allah sometimes uses the singular tense. In this verse, Allah is using the singular tense. In another Quranic verse, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَفِظُونَ. We are the ones that have revealed the Quran, and we are the ones that are going to preserve it. Hum hi woh hai jinhone Quran ko nazil kiya. Hum hi woh hai jo Quran ki hifazat farmayenge. Allah ne wahan jama ka lafz istemal kiya. Yahan Allah wahid ka lafz istemal kar raha hai. Sa'asrif, very soon, asrif, I will turn away an ayati from my signs. Whom will Allah turn away from His ayat, from His signs? Hum apni nishaniyon se un logo ko main pher lunga. I will turn them away from the right path. Sa'asrif an ayati alladhina yatakabbaruna fil ardi bighayri alhaq. I will turn away those people who are walking on the earth with arrogance without any right. Allah protect us. Aaj ka insan takabbur ujub karta hai. He has pride and arrogance in him. He has got this quality, which was the quality which the shirka, which the first sin that was ever created. The first sin that was ever created, that was ever done by any Allah's creation, was none but kibr. Allah. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told all the malaika, all the creations, bow to Adam alayhi salam, bow down to Adam alayhi salam, what did Iblis say? Ana khayrun min, ana khayrun min, khalaqtahu, khalaqtani min nar, wa khalaqtahu min tin. Oh Allah, I am better than him. You have created him from clay. You have created me from fire. And fire supersedes clay, subhanAllah. This was the very first sin ever to be done. This was the sin, which is the sin of kibr and ujub, arrogance and pride. This is the very thing Allah is mentioning in this verse. سَأَصْرِفْ عَنْ آيَاتِيَ الَّذِينَ يَتَكَبَّرُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ. That I will turn away from my signs. I will turn away from recognizing me. So from here, what do we learn, Abdullah? What do we learn, Abdurrahman? Allah takes away the intellect of that person who disobeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first consequence of arrogance is that he becomes ignorant, subhanAllah. That is why we see on the face of this earth today, all the oppressors, all the tyrants have no brains in their head. They torture people to the extreme because they have got arrogance in themselves. They have got ujb and takabbur and they have got iman and they have got rebellion against the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. سَأَصْرِفْ عَنْ آيَاتِيَ الَّذِينَ يَتَكَبَّرُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I will turn these people away from my signs who have arrogance in themselves, who have takabbur, who have pride and takabbur in themselves on the face of this earth without any right. What right do me and you have to faith to walk on the face of this earth with arrogance and not? We should think, what are we created from? What are we created from? وَالسَّمَاءِ وَالطَّارِقِ وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا الطَّارِقِ النَّجْمُ فلينظر الإنسان مما خلق فلينظر الإنسان مما خلق خلق من ماء دافق يخرج من بين الصلب والترائب إنه على رجعه لقادر. What are we created for? We should see what are we being created. How can we walk on the face of this earth with insolence and arrogance? This is why an Arabic poet says, Awwaluka, Awwaluka, nutfatul madira. Awwaluka, nutfatul madira. What was your beginning? How did you come into existence? You came into existence with a semen which was unclean, Allah knows. Napa katre se kuperakwa. Awwaluka, nutfatul madira. You were created. What was your beginning? You were made from a semen, and if that semen was to go onto your clothes, you will have to clean that clothes. You will not become barak until you don't clean that garment of yours. Awwaluka, nutfatun madira. And what is going to be your end? Wa akhiruka, jifatun qadira. And your end is going to be, you're going to be a stinking corpse. Allah protect us, ameen ya Allah. If a human being was to die, our life, we should go out in the world and we should explore and see many times the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah give jazai khair to our tablighi brothers, mashallah. Alhamdulillah, they are doing the work of da'wah, going out and meeting people and bringing them to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah give them jazai khair. But we need to go ourselves and we need to see the situation of the ummah. And I myself have been in situations where, unfortunately, I have had to see a dead corpse in a bath, Allah. You remember the tsunami? The tsunami that came, was it on Boxing Day? What day was it? I can't remember. I think it was on Boxing Day many years ago. And the tsunami came with its force in Indonesia. And we were given the opportunity to go there and see the after effects of the tsunami. And after so many days we went, we could still see bodies wrapped in black bags, Allah. Yeah. Wrapped in black bags. So if a corpse is to be left there for a few days, that's why Islam says, give ghusl to the mayyit, ghusl to the deceased, put kafur onto the body, put kafur onto the body, onto the places of sajda, and then bury the deceased, just in case the smell of that corpse starts to spread and people start to say bad words regarding the deceased. Islam stops that, says, give ghusl in this place, subhanAllah. Eh? Look at what Islam has considered, even for a dead person, Allah. This is the greatness of our deen. Allahu Akbar. Awwaluka nutfatun madira wa akhiruka jifatun qadira. وَأَنْتَ فِي مَا بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ تَحْمِلُ الْعَظِرَ. And what is your situation? Whilst your first day till your last day in this period of yours, which is called our life, our hayat. Yeah, what were we doing? We were going around with filth, filth in our stomachs. Yes or no, yeah? Coming back to the point of the toilet, if we didn't have that to relieve ourselves, we would die with the very thing in our bodies, Allah. And you ask those people who unfortunately have got an illness of not being able to pass through or not being able to urine and urinate, what difficulties they go through, Allah. Yeah? The constipation. You ask a person who's got constipation, a child who has constipation, the mom can't sleep all night, Allah. Yeah? Maybe the father goes to sleep. MashaAllah, yeah. So yeah, mummy can come in, I want to carry you, inshallah. Eh? We don't worry about that. It's the women's job, yeah? That's our attitude, Allah. So we go to sleep. Allahumma bismika, amutu wa ahya. Dua for me, abdila kalamiha. I don't want nothing to do with it anymore. You take care of the kids. This is the love of the mother, subhanAllah. Yeah? This is why Allah gives her three times more status than the father, subhanAllah. That's the mother. What can we say? We don't want to go into the issue of the parents' rights and the mother's rights at the moment, inshallah, on another occasion. But here, the child has got constipation. The mother can't sleep all night. She's worried. She's sacrificing her sleep for the sake of her child. My child, give it this medicine, give it that medicine. Relief. And if a child or somebody or one of us was to get diarrhea, Lord, diarrhea, then it just keeps on coming out. There's no stopping, yeah? Again, severe problem, yeah? You must bring them out. Your stomach. What are you gonna do? Run out to the toilet, yeah? Don't stay there, be gonna be a big problem, yeah? If you do it in the masjid, there'll be a problem again. If you've got an issue of illness, Sharia is so clear cut. You don't need to come to masjid. If you've got an illness, that's why Islam is so pure. If a person has got the illness of bad smell, sometimes Allah Ta'ala protect us, inshallah, people have the illness of ibit, not to ibit. A bad smell from the armpits. This is an illness may Allah save us and protect us, yeah? But Sharia says, if a person has that illness, then they should try and avoid in coming into the masjid and stay for long durations. If they want, they can come maybe last minute and go out straight away. Come last minute and go. This is the level of taqwa a person has. But some ulama have also said, if he's going to harm and give trouble to his Muslim fellow, then he should not come to the masjid. Some ulama have gone to the next step. What we're trying to say is Islam is all clear cut, right? The injunctions are clear. Somebody has got a problem of diarrhea. Somebody's got a problem of constipation. Again, we need to go and make sure that we relieve ourselves. This is why even at that occasion, Rasulullah ﷺ also taught us a dua. He taught us a dua after we relieve ourselves. Yeah? We teach that to our children, our maktab. Do we read that? Big question. Do we read that? It's a big question. We teach it to our children and we make sure we teach them properly. But how much do they bring into practice what they learn? Do we make a note of, did you pray the dua before you went to the toilet? Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubuthi wal-khaba'i. Did you pray the dua after you came out? Ghufranak, ghufranak. Subhanallah. All mercies from Allah. Allah, we thank you, forgive us. Ghufranak. Alhamdulillah, alladhi adhhab 'anni al-adha wa 'afani. Subhanallah. All praise is due to Allah who took away from that which could be harmful for me, and He has relieved me. Subhanallah. A great blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every ni'mat of Allah is the sign of Allah's qudrat. Subhanallah. Coming back to the issue, wa anta fi ma bayna dhalik tahmilu al-'adhab. The point says your starting was that you were created by the small semen and sperm, which is nabat, and your ending is that you will be left. If you were to be left without shrouding, without bathing, then you would be a stinking corpse. And in between, you are carrying filth in your body. Then why this arrogance? Why this arrogance? Do not walk on this earth with arrogance. إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَخْرِقَ الْأَرْضِ وَلَنْ تَبْلُغَ الْجِبَالَ طُولًا. You cannot open the earth up and you cannot reach the heights of the mountain by yourself. Say, Shaykh, wait a minute. Nowadays people climb the Everest mountain. And they've climbed the mountain. Allah says, وَلَنْ تَبْلُغَ الْجِبَالَ طُولًا. That they will not be able to climb on the heights of the mountain. So isn't this against the Quran? نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ. Let me make it clear. Everest is not the only mountain which Allah has created, yeah? Number one. There are many other mountains which Allah Ta'ala has created which are more higher than the Everest, yeah? That is the only one maybe they've been able to go. There are other mountains which they have not been able to go. And even if they do go, they have to go with the aid of so many things, subhanAllah, yeah? They can't just go and have to take all their gear with them, subhanAllah, you know? All the breathing gear, all the wearing gear, whatnot. They have to do by the time they go to the top of a mountain. This is the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Insan, he cannot do nothing without the will and the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah s.a.w. mentions in one hadith, in regards to this qibla and ujra and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala and in Nabiya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the consequence is so severe. La yadkhulul jannah, la yadkhulul jannah, man kana fi qalbihi مثقال ذرة من كبر. الله أكبر. not that person will not enter paradise. Wo shakhs jannat mein dakhil na hoga jiske dil mein rai ke dane ke barabar bhi takabbur hoga. Allah hi fazal farmaye, Allah protect us. The one who has arrogance, pride, even to the amount of one small potter, an iota of takabbur will be the means of a person being deprived of entering into Jannah. Now what severe consequence can there be? What more severe can there be? Man kana fi qalbihi mithqalu dharratin min kibar. Whose heart will have an iota of takabbur will not enter paradise. Immediately, a man was sitting there. Allahu Akbar, Qurban jaye sahabe kiram, ridwanullah ajma'in. They immediately would pose a question. Ya Rasulullah, faqala rajul, a man says, faqala rajulun, a man says, ar-rajul yuhibbu an yakuna thawbuhu hasana wa an yakuna na'luhu hasana. A man wants that his clothes are nice and smart and he's presenting in a good way. You know, nowadays the Giorgio Armani's, yeah, walking out like that, man, I'm something, man, chill out, man, yeah. And then he's walking down the street, he wants attention. He's got the new, you know, he's been to the Christmas sales. Who's going to go to the New Year sales? Put your hands up. Nobody? I'm going. Maybe in my dreams, huh? Yeah? New Year sab jaate hai, mujhe sab bataya. Don't think that we saw Sufis here, mashallah, yeah. Yeah, we all get advantage of the sales, yeah? Yes or no, brother? Mashallah, yeah? Yeah, who's it? There's nothing wrong, man. Don't worry. But don't go 2 o'clock in the morning, subhanAllah, yeah? I hear people go to morning 2 o'clock, but they never wake up for tahajjud, yeah? I said, why did you go? Sheikh, what can I say? Allah made it easy for me. Subhanallah. How did Allah make it easy for you? Subhanallah. Sheikh, Allah gave me the tawfiq to buy something. It was costing £300. And it was in sale for £100. No, two thirds of the price was gone. This was the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah, what time did you finish? Sheikh, there was a big queue, yeah? There was a big queue. Subhanallah, so what happened? If you remember, brothers, Ramadan was in winter. Yeah? At that time, nobody had problems. Muslims were the first, outside, next, subhanAllah. And by the time suhoor comes, you're there. No? So, they say, they go, subhanAllah, what happened next? Sheikh, but there was a big queue, and I had to wait. And the stores opened at about 6 o'clock. I went inside. And then I got that stuff which I wanted, mashallah, for the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yeah? Subhanallah, what happened next? Sheikh, you know, once I was in the store, and I thought to myself, wait a minute, there's many other things you can buy as well. Bargains are there. Go for it, man, go for it, yeah? He says, okay. Then I went and got a few more things as well. Then I remembered, wait a minute, what about my missus, yeah? I'm gonna forget her. So I can get something for her as well. And then, by the time I came to the till, what time was it? Came late and late, and I missed my jamaat. And by the time I got out of the car park, it became 8:20. By the time I got home, it was 8:30. My fajr namaz had gone. What benefit is there? They bought something which was worth 300 for £100, but there can be nothing which can compare to the loss of that one salah that a person misses, subhanAllah. One salah. فَإِنَّ in one hadith, Rasulullah says, مَنْ تَرَكَ صَلَاةً مَكْتُوبَةً مُتَعَمِّدًا. Whosoever will miss one salah on purpose, فَقَدْ بَرِعَتْ مِنْهُ ذِمَّةُ اللَّهِ, then he will no longer remain in the protection of Allah. What benefit is there? Today you bought something which was worth £300 2 days ago. Today you bought it for 100. But now today you have lost the protection of your Lord. What have you achieved? So coming back to the point again. Many a time people will say, the Sahabi said, that a man wants his clothes to be nice. Walking on the street, eat day, good mashallah. We shouldn't be tatty. I would say, especially in today's day and age, Muslimano ko zara muhassab anda se milna chahiye, achhe kapde pehenne chahiye. Khaas taur par hamare wo tabqa ke log ke jinko gairon ko Islam pesh karna hai, उनको तो मौले मुहज्जब भी होना चाहिए, वरना लोग देख कर ही कहेंगे कि ये मुसलमान ऐसे, इज दिस द वे दे रिलीजन इज, दे प्रेजेंट देमसेल्व्स इन सच अ यू नो इरिस्पांसिबल वे, एंड इज दिस व्हाट दे आर, इफ दे आर प्रेजेंटिंग देमसेल्व्स द फर्स्ट इंप्रेशन इज द लास्ट इंप्रेशन. सो इफ यू गिव अ रॉन्ग इंप्रेशन टू द पर्सन and you present Islam in the wrong way, and you think Islam is a religion which, you know, is na'udhu billah, na'udhu billah, na'udhu billah, you know, going back to back days, it's not. Islam is not for the back days. Islam was there for the future. Islam is now for the future. Islam is a living religion, subhanAllah. Remember my words, Islam is a living religion. It came into existence. Islam came into existence since the time of Adam ala nabiyyina alayhi salatu wa taslim. The religion of obedience to Allah was Islam. But we Muslims have been given this special title as a Muslim because of the great honorable Prophet Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We were given these titles. Other ummats, other nations were not given this title. But we are called Muslims. Basically, this beautiful light of Islam. Of this modern day and age, starting with the Nur of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it will remain until the day of Qiyamah, inshallah. Eh? Say inshallah, eh? It will remain. But Islam will be there, it's living and kicking. But is it for me and you to adopt it and take from it? Subhanallah. Sa'asrifu an ayati alladhina yatakabbaruna fil ardi bighayr al-haq. I was explaining the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A man poses a question. A man likes that his clothes are nice. A man likes that his shoes are nice. Wants to buy the shoe from Foot Locker. Yeah? Wants to buy the shoe from the expensive store. Eid is coming up. They want to buy the nice garments. The nice shoe. Why? Where is it? No problem. Don't have arrogance. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thank Allah for this ni'mah that He's given you. You want to wear the best clothes? Wear it. Thank Allah. Rasulullah gave a reply. This is why they say wear it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna Allah jameelun yuhibbul jamal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that possesses the quality of jamal, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes a person to be handsome. Subhanallah. Inna Allah jameel yuhibbul jamal. What Allah doesn't like. Further, Rasulullah mentions, Al-kibr, arrogance, batarul haq, is rejecting the truth of Allah. Rejecting haq. Haq baat ko tukra dena. Batarul haq. Wa ghamtun nas. And to think people of lower than inferior. Logo ko ghatiya samajhna. Na'udhu billahi minna. This is why Rasulullah mentions here. In regards to this person who possesses arrogance. Many ahadith have come in regards to saving yourself from arrogance and pride. Pride is when a person feels in himself, he feels a feeling of something in his heart. But when he expresses that in front of others, that is what you call arrogance. That's what you call arrogance. Nowadays, people show arrogance to the highest level, na'udhu billahi min dhalik, in all forms and shape. Allah protect us, ameen ya rabbal alamin. Allah hame bachaye. Is bimari se Hazrat ne hamari tawajjuh dilayi ruhani cheez ki. These are our spiritual ailments. Like I said, this is the sin which creates many other sins. Many other sins breed from this sin, from this illness of rajah and takabbur. You get jealousy. Jealousy is created because the person is arrogant. Anger is created because the person has got arrogance. Then you have a person having the not only jealousy and anger, but then they go to the level of backbiting about someone. They talk bad about them because they want to be belittled in front of other people's eyes. Na'udhu billah. Then you get people who have the sin of tajassus. Yeah, tajassus. Na'udhu billahi min dhalik. Then you have self-purification, self-glorification. A person starts mentioning himself high in front of others. This is all the root of kibr and ujub. Allah protect us and save us from that, inshallah. Eh? Allah Ta'ala make our hearts pure from kibr and ujub. Because this illness, this spiritual ailment is such that Rasulullah says, La yadkhulul jannah. that person would not enter into paradise. Allah protect us, yeah? In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, عن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال يقول الله عز وجل حديث قدس Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states Al-Izzu Izzari Wal-Kibriyahu Ritari Subhanallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states this honor is glory is my garments is my garment is my izar is my lower garment you can say it's what I cover myself with Wal-Kibriyahu Ritari and this highness and this glory and this first this being which is higher than anybody else this is my grand lord whosoever will try to take them away from me faman yunazuni azabtuhu aw kama qala alayhi salatu wassalam rawahu muslim rahimahullah whosoever will try to take these qualities away create izz in him create kibr in him I will give him punishment. Allah protect us. Amin ya Rabbal Alamin. And we know many a nations that came before us, they were dealt with by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of this very sin of takabbur and rujhah. Sa'asrif an ayatiya alladhina yatakabbaruna fil ardi bighayri alhaqq. And Allah says further, وَإِن يَرَوْا كُلَّ آيَةٍ لَا يُؤْمِنُ بِهَا. If they were to see every sign of Allah's Qudra, they would not believe it. Sign upon sign upon sign. Allah gives us, أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبْلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ. You see the camel of Allah's creating. Have you not seen the sky, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how He's creating it? Allah says, وَفِي أَنْفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. See within yourselves the eyes and the heart and the hands and the mind and the tongue, and all the limbs of our body, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created them. وَفِي أَنْفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. Do you not see the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? These are the signs and the ayat of Allah. If we don't see them, and by looking at them, if we don't recognize our Lord, in reality, we have failed in our maqsad and our mission in life. And that is to make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pleased so that we can gain the ultimate goal, which is Jannah inshaAllah. Which is Jannah inshaAllah. وَإِن يَرَوْا كُلَّ آيَةٍ لَا يُؤْمِنُ بِهَا وَإِن يَرَوْا سَبِيلَ الرُّشْدِ لَا يَتَّخِذُوهُ سَبِيلًا. If they are to see these very arrogant people, these arrogant people who think they are high, who think they are something. Nowadays you get the drug dealers, you get the pimps, you get this, you get that. They want a position, they want to create something, they want some kind of honor and privilege to be held in the community. How do they try and gain it? Through arrogance. This is the core issue, the core problem. Why do they want such honor? Because at the end of the day, they want to feel that they are high. This is why a Urdu poet says, Mita de apni hasti ko, Mita de apni hasti ko, gar kuch martaba chahiye Allah. He says that take away and forget your own self-glorification. If you forget that you want to achieve this rank, then you will become somebody who has got a person of rank, subhanAllah. This is why my Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us a dua. Allahumma aj'alni sabura, waj'alni shakura, waj'alni fi ayni sabira. Oh Allah, make me low in the eyes of the people. Waj'alni fi ayni sabira. Allah, make me low in my own eyes. Don't make me feel high of myself. And Allah, it's within your power, it's within your limit, it's within your qudrat that you give honor for me in the eyes of the people. وَفِي أَعْيُنِ النَّاسِ كَبِيرًا. اللهم اجعلني صبورا واجعلني شكورا واجعلني في عيني صغيرا. Make me feel glow of myself وفي أعين الناس كبيرا. Allah تعالى give me عزة and honor in the eyes of the people. This was the dua of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. In today's day age, Abdullah bin Rahman, Fatima Zainab, people want to live their lives against the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, وَإِنْ يَرَوْا سَبِيلَ الرُّشْدِ. If they were to see the path of righteousness. I was mentioning the Urdu couplets, مِتَادِ أَبْنِي حَسِيبُ غَرْ كُشْ مَرْتَبَا شَاهِيَ. Forget your own ego. Forget your own pride. Forget your own vanity. Forget your own status. If you want to achieve the status in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, kidana khaf me minkar gune gustar bach jata hai, subhanallah. That's a seed. A seed, if it gets mixed up and loses itself through the dust, eventually you will be able to see the greenery of that seed, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we don't need to think high of ourselves. Allah Himself will give us izzah and honor, inshallah. Allah, this is an issue which I really don't want to go into more depth on. It's coming back to the Quran in verse 110. Brothers are happy to stay, inshallah. Subhanallah, yeah? You want to make me tired, inshallah? Inshallah, yeah? This guy says, yeah, but mashallah. Allah help me, inshallah, yeah? Sa'asrifu an ayati al-ladina. يتكبرون في الأرض بغير الحق وإن يروا كل آية لا يؤمنوا بها وإن يروا سبيل الرشد. عبد الله بن رحمن فاطمة زينب. The question is, which path do we want to choose? كونسا لاستعمى اختيار. Do we want to choose the path of النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم؟ لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة. You are indeed God, a good example in the life of Muhammad al-Arabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a topic in itself. Sabeel al-Rush, do you want to adopt that guidance, that path, in which regarding Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, كُلَّ أُمَّتِي يَدْخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَبَى. Every ummah of mine will enter into paradise except that person who rejects. Who will reject? The Sahaba asked, من أطاعني دخل الجنة ومن أصاني فقد أبى. Whosoever will be obedient to me, meaning the Muhammad al-Arabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he will enter into paradise, and whosoever will be disobedient to me, he will in reality be rejecting my ways of life, my ways and my practices. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said to us clearly, man ahabba sunnati. Today, who do we know? People nowadays, mashallah, they want to follow the pop stars, yeah? Well, not Jackson anymore, yeah? Because it's gone, yeah? There's many others people want to follow, make them their icon, ideal. You got your football stars, you got Ronaldo, and you got Beckham or whatever, yeah? I don't know about Bali Football Club. Who do you have, mashallah, eh? Do you have anybody, yeah? Abdullah, mashallah, eh? Abdullah, the nice player, mashallah, eh? So you have Abdullah for the Bali Football Team, yeah? And then, you've got people who want to follow the singers. And then fashion. Everybody is basically engrossed and indulged with trying to follow a certain fashion. You know, I can remember in my old days, my young days, sorry, not my old days, I can remember in my young days, they used to have the flares, you know, the flares as a style for the women. I mean, my young sister, my sisters used to wear the flares. It's a style, flares, you know. Then it became a time, na'udhu billah, that became to tights, you know. And I think as far as I found not wrong, the flares have come back again into style. So it's a vicious cycle. It goes round and round in circles. Wanting the style goes away, come back another day. Yeah? Nowadays you get Ajib style, subhanAllah. That day I saw a person walking into the street here, yeah, with his trousers half down, subhanAllah. Yeah? So tell this guy how his trousers are going down, yeah? So what's the problem?
His trousers are going down. Yeah? In fact, that was what I could see, his underwear, yeah? So, Sheikh, don't you know? I says, what's the problem? Just tell the guy. It's going to expose part of his body, yeah? It's not nice to see, you know? It's not a nice scene. Ajee! Sheikh, you don't know? I says, what? That's time, man! I says, what? There's a style what's up to your underwear, Ajee! What next, man? What next for a meal? If you got to the underwear, what next do you want to show? That was a mizahi. Ajee, you want to show the underwear? And you know, you could literally, I just looked at the guy. I said, he's feeling so much strain in walking in that place, man. He's not even comfortable. He's not walking comfortably. You know? Ajee, this thing is doing a moonwalk. Wow, man, yeah? Ajee, the guy. He's walking like that. I said, wait a minute, brother, are you comfortable? Yeah, man, yeah, don't worry. I'm fine. Ajee, this guy is walking with strain. Women nowadays, they want to go for the latest fashion. You'll see some of them, you know, sometimes you see women with this big heels. Ajee. I says, how can they walk? I said, they do walk. They walk with strain, subhanAllah. This is sacrifice for the sake of nafs, subhanAllah. Sacrifice for the sake of nafs. You'll see many of the people on a cold winter's day, on a Friday and a Saturday night, they'll be walking on the street with barely any clothes on. We think, subhanAllah, main to masjid mein jata hu, coat pehenta hu, fir scarf pehenta hu, uske upar bubble hat pehenta hu, and how many pairs of socks do I wear, subhanAllah? And I go to the masjid, I have to take everything off, that's to anomala, to wear everything again. Guy walking on the street with his chest on that, yeah? He's gone, no, why does it feel cold, man? And women, na'uzubillah, walking on the streets, half naked. Allahu Akbar. And if you really go to the bottom, to the core of this, why do they wear that? It comes again because of style and arrogance. They want to show that I'm up to date. Nowadays, you get the new jubbas coming out, subhanAllah. Even Islamic dress has become fashionable, Ajeeb, Allah. Ajeeb. You get the latest style. They want to try and say, Sheikh, nowadays youngsters want to wear jubba, mashallah. So, alhamdulillah, sunnah. Yeah, Sheikh, but you have to give them a bit of a tweak it up a bit, you know? Give them a bit of an alternative, yeah? Mashallah, what alternative do you wish to give? Sheikh, you know, we have to create the style. You know, so if they have this jubba, they can wear it and feel proud of it. We want Islam to be at the forefront, Sheikh. This is our purpose. MashaAllah. Allah bless you if the intention is sincere. But generally, that's not the case. Generally, is they want to try and follow the latest trends. Then you have our sisters, MashaAllah. You got the George Armani scarves, MashaAllah. Then you have the jubbas, which are the latest styles as well. Ajee, it's a rat race. You see, in the dunya, everybody is going behind fashion, fashion, fashion. Why? Because they want to feel proud of themselves. But if they were to wear that fashion for the sake of their husbands, if a person was to wear that jubba for the sake of pleasing the Lord, fine. Like I said, Inna Allah Jamilun Yuhibbul Jamal, to create a balance in the topic of discussion. If you want to wear that, but your niyat is, I want to present Islam. Not that you feel that when people will see me, they'll say, oh, he's got a very expensive jubba on. Not that they will say, oh, he's got a jubba on. This jubba is worth £200. Not for that purpose. The purpose is that I'm going to fight Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then we have a situation of our young children. Our young children, then they ask, obviously, when they see their friends, they also say, Papa, Mama, I want to wear that jubba. Get another one. Mustafa is good enough. Man, mashallah. Asim is good enough. No. I want to go for the top range, shah. Top range jubba. Why? My friend's going to wear it, so I'm going to wear it. Yeah. My friend's going to wear it, so I'm going to wear it. If they were to wear it with good intention, there was nothing wrong. Again, coming back to the core issue, is the niyyah inside? Is the niyyah in our hearts? What intention do we have in having this fashion? Sabeel al-Rushd. They don't want to adopt. The path of the pious and the righteousness. We don't want to adopt. We want to forsake that. We want to choose the path which fulfills our desires and nafs. We want to fulfill the call by which people would say, MashaAllah. Very good. Look at that guy, man. And nowadays you get people doing ajeeb things. Ajeeb. Walking down the street, you'll get youngsters walking in groups, talking out loud, subhanAllah. Oh, man, let go, man. They're screaming to each other. Yeah, man, buddy, it's okay, man. How are you? Bruv. Yeah? How's it going? Bruv. Now you get girls saying, how's it going, bruv? You see, using the same word. First, I thought, what's this bruv, man? Yeah? So what's this word come from? That's always an alternative now to bro. This was a bro, now it's bruv. Is there anything else now? No, mashallah. At least I'm up to date, mashallah. Yeah? I'm up to date with the words they use. Like Sheikh was mentioning, Winslow Road, mashallah, yeah? And Mumtaz restaurant, mashallah, yeah? But, wallahi, the real issue is, Sabeel al-Rushd, the path of the righteousness, the path of goodness, the path of piety, the path of piety. If they are told to adopt this, وَإِنْ يَرَوْا سَبِيلَ الرُّشْدْ لَا يَتَّخِذُوا سَبِيلًا. Then they do not take that as their way of life. وَإِنْ يَرَوْا سَبِيلَ الْغَيْبِ يَتَّخِذُوا سَبِيلًا. If you are to tell the youngster, you are to tell the only youngsters today, even our elders, na'udhu billah, many a times we are also being victims of this very act of kibr and rushd. Allah protect us, ameen ya rabbal. Wa iyyaw sabeel al-ghayb. If they were to see the path of wickedness, of evil, Musa bhai is having his daughter's wedding. And Haji Musa sahab, wo kaha jaye ki bachchi ka nikah hai. Mauli sahab, kya kar, bachchi manti. My daughter is not listening to me. She wants to keep the band baja. She wants to keep this. She wants to call. Nowadays you get the mehndi parties actually. Yeah? You get the mehndi parties and then you don't know what you get after that. And there's a sequence of events before the mehndi day, subhanAllah, yeah? So you got one after the other after the other. So then they wanted now, I heard that they also called down bhangra parties. They called down people to do band baja. Achee? So Musa bhai said, Mauli sahab, nah, what can I do? My daughter said, if you don't do it, I'm going to go away. I'm going to leave the home. Achoo. My daughter says she's going to leave the home. And this is Izzah, my honor. Come on, Shaykh. You know, myself. Kya kare aaj kal majboor hai. Agar beti ye keh rahi hai, chal bhai iman. Where is our iman in ghairat all the time? Why can't we pull ourselves and say, if you want to do that, lakum dinukum waliya. You go your way, and I go mine. You can do what you want to do, but you will not have your father's presence in that activity. But me, Musa bhai, then kya karenge? Hazrat Musa ji, apna shuta pehnenge, mashallah. Ajeeb beti ki mangni mein jana hai. Ajeeb beti ki mehndi mein jana hai. Toh tumhari bhi mehndi lagegi na. What's gonna happen? Musa ji is gonna say, justify, and I have to go because my daughter's wedding, my daughter's engagement, my daughter's mehndi, I have to participate. I have no choice. It's my daughter. You have a choice. You have a choice. And the choice is you give them the ultimatum. You want to do everything, it has to do according to the Sharia and the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If it's against that, I'm sorry, but I ain't gonna participate. I will come to your nikah because that is Sunnah. I will participate in the nikah because that is Sunnah. That is the practice of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But in regards to everything else, you make a point, and if you don't make yourself present there, you will see, wallahi, they will change their mind, inshallah. And that is for the good, because you are saving them from falling into the pits of hell. You are saving them from falling into the traps of shaitan. وَإِنْ يَرَوْ سَبِيلَ الْغَيْءِ يَتَّخِرُوا سَبِيلًا. If they were to see the path of wickedness, they would adopt it. Aaj kal hum dekhe, Allah maafa, many a sins that were unthinkable, that were not even thought of, are being committed in so-called our Muslim countries. Yeah. I'm not calling them Islamic, because they ain't Islamic. Yeah. Muslim countries, because Muslims' presence are there. But na'udhu billahi min dhalik. sometimes we see our Muslim community is celebrating a activity and a program more than our indigenous population. You know, in the time of Christmas, we just went through the 25th of December. You must have noticed it was a quiet day, eh? All the roads were empty. Hardly any police presence, yes or no, yeah? This is what I see in my town, Lock. But then when it's Eid day, Allah, this is their annual rejoicing day. They're going to be in their homes with their own families, maybe having the Christmas turkey, yeah? But what do Muslims do? Ajib. I don't know if about battle, but I know about life. On the day of Eid, it's chaos. It depends which day we celebrate as well. It's a different issue in itself, yeah? Allah make us all one, inshallah, yeah? But anyway, the day of Eid, which day of Eid, whichever day of Eid they normally celebrate, you see the situation I see in my town in Bangalore, a sad situation. You have police on cover, you have police, patrol, people will be having the flags of other countries. Go back to that country. Why don't you go and live there? You'll find out. Nobody is going to be honest. You find out. What's there about showing a flag of another country in a country that you're living in here? Our forefathers came, whether they came for monetary reasons, for a better future, we're here today. We were born in this country. We've been brought up in this country. This is our country. This is the country that we've been brought up in. This is the culture and the situation we're living in. How dare we give any trouble to the indigenous population? We should be thankful that they allow us to celebrate Eid, subhanAllah. And today, on Eid Day, we want to have full blast music, flags waving around of other countries. Not only that, but going into neighborhoods where there are elderly people living there and disturbing them. Not only that, but we've not even spared the Qabristan. We've not even spared the graveyards. On the day of Eid, people go to the graveyards and then they cause havoc. Parking cars, if there was a non-Muslim who was, if it's Eid would come on a Sunday, for example, and then that Sunday a non-Muslim was to go and visit the graveyard, that's what's happening here. I can't have access to my beloved one. I can't have access. Muslims will park their cars as though it belongs to them. Now, is this our character? Is this the way we should live in this country of ours? We have a right and responsibility in the society that we live in. We have a right and responsibility to fulfill for our humanitarian brothers and sisters. We have a right to fulfill those things. Muslim today is celebrating Eid against the will of Allah and His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is why what we are facing is what we are facing. Wallahi, if we Muslims were to go to the better and follow the sunnah of Habib Baqir Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam and celebrate Eid in the way Eid should be celebrated, we would not face these issues and problems. But the problem is that we are celebrating them against the Quran and sunnah. We will have Eid parties, na'udhubillah. Eid mela, na'udhubillah. It's mela in itself. Mela means ganda. Then you have Eid Melas, people under the name of cultural events. I'm not talking about Bali Arab Lok, but I know many places in the country who keep a cultural event, Eid celebrations, and they have a Mela, and then they get Mela in there. They do evil activities. Wallahi, if we are to come onto the Sunnah, Sunnah is going to be the way we are going to get blessings on the face of this earth. The barakah of sunnah, we will see evident in our lives, inshallah. Forget the akhirah. Akhirah is reserved for us. It's dunya mein. Sunnat par amal karne ka fayda hame khud zahir, inshallah. We will see it with our own eyes. We will experience it. We will experience the barakah of sunnah in our lives. But know of the love of Rahman Fatima Zainab, like I said, walking in the street in groups, calling each other, talking loud. And this illness, I've seen, you know, I've been teaching, alhamdulillah, for the last 25 years, alhamdulillah. I don't look my age, by the way, yeah? You may think of yourself, how old are you, right? I don't want to say that, it's a secret. But, alhamdulillah, I've been teaching for the last 25 years. And I've seen a change, even in the attitudes of students. This evil that is outside has an influence even on our students that come to our Darul Ulooms, on our madaris and our maktab. Rasulullah he was not a person who would scream and shout in the bazaars, in the supermarkets. Again, day and age, you see, forget the supermarkets. Youngsters would be walking in groups, talking loud, and trying to get attention towards them. This is nothing good. It's a despicable act. If you want to sing something to somebody, talk softly. It's the best thing to do. No, don't speak loud. You want to show their presence. You want to show them that I am walking here. Allah save us and protect us. This is what Allah mentions in the Quran. وَلَا تُسَعِّرْ خَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَمْشِرْ فَالْأَرْضِ مَرْحَ. Do not walk on the earth with your cheeks up. People nowadays, but Allah says, وَلَا تُسَعِّرْ وَلَا تُسَعِّرْ خَدَّكَ وَلَا تُسَعِّرْ خَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ. Do not put your cheeks up. Do not feel proud of walking in this way. Don't feel proud. وَلَا تُسَعِّرْ خَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَمْشِرْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرْحَ. When a person talks, خَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ, one explanation would be to walk with a cheek heart. And they ignore people. What do you want? Yeah? The guy is talking here. What do you want? Oh, yeah. All right. Oh, I see, yeah? This is the attitude. They talk. They think they're the boss. The boss goes, somebody, an employee, knocks on the door. Knock, knock. Who's that? It's Muhammad. Come in. Yeah. Yeah. I want my week's salary in advance. Yeah? I want my week's salary in advance. I'm not mine. What do you want to get advance for, yeah? Give me the same coming here. You're wasting my time, are you? It's just a request. He just wants his salary a week in advance. Maybe he's got some need. He needs to fulfill. But again, خَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ. He's on the seat of being the owner. He's the director. He's the chairman. What if he has no chair? Where is he going to go then? Yeah? Is he going to be the floor man? I wonder. He's the chairman anymore. He's the floor man. Yeah? Chairman! His chair's not there anymore. He's going to be the floor man. Yeah? I'm the floor manager. Well, and this guy's the floor manager. The team manager. He has some kind of a... in his mind, I am superior to them. Wallahi, when these people work with people with as a team and doesn't have this in their mind that I am superior to this person, Allah will give birth. When a person is the owner of a company and he treats his employees with respect and honor, they will make dua for him in tahajjud, inshallah. But if he treats them in an insolent, in a way with insults them, they would be swearing behind his back. But the only reason I go there, because I need a weekly salary. Because I need an earning. Otherwise I'd spit on his face. Yeah. That's the way it is. Reality. It's reality. وَلَا تُسَكِّرْ خَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تُمْشِكْ الْأَرْضِ مَرْحَ. Don't walk on this earth with arrogance and insolence. Allah says further, وَقْسُ فِي مَشْرِكَ وَغْضُبْ مِنْ صَوْتِكَ. That when you talk, talk in a manner which is subdued. Don't raise your voice. When you walk, walk modestly. When you walk, وَقْسِبْ فِي مَشْرِكَ. Walk with modesty. And then lower your voice. For the worst of the voices is the voice and the brain of a donkey. إِنَّ أَنْكَرَ الْأَصْوَاتِ لَسَوْتُ الْحَمْدِ. People want to talk in that way. Again, coming back to the point, attention, arrogance, putting a mark, showing people that I am here, my presence is here. All these illnesses are sabirul ghayb, the path of wickedness. When a person is told to follow that path, they want to choose it. They want to choose it. Remember what I said initially. The first consequence of arrogance is Allah takes away the intellect. He cannot differentiate between haq and batil. If we cure ourselves, inshallah, say inshallah, yeah? From this core illness, which is kibr and ujub, if we clear ourselves, inshallah, we will be successful. Once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to conclude, inshallah, once he was mentioning a lengthy hadith, he gave some advice, nasiha. Abu Dharr, in Sahabi was Abu Dharr. He says to him, وَإِيَّاكَ وَإِسْبَالِ الْإِزَارِ. Another problem. Walking with our trousers below the ankles. إِيَّاكَ وَإِسْبَالِ الْإِزَارِ فَإِنَّهَا مِنَ الْمَخِيرَةِ وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمَخِيرَةِ. People walking with their garments below the ankles. Whether it be jubba, nowadays you have these styles of jubbas. You want to be free street cleaners, mashallah. Yeah? It's dragging it along, yeah? Like a Mexi, they used to call it Mexi guitar, so you know. Like a dress, man. They want to clean the streets. Free street clean, I call these people. Well, yeah. You want to call them clean the streets, call these guys, the big jubbas, yeah? Sky. They are walking with the jubbas under their feet. And it's getting dirty. But they are walking. No problem. They want to walk quite arrogance. It's a style. A cheat. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this is a sign of arrogance. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam never, ever wore a garment which was beneath his ankles. Ma asfala min al ka'bayni min al izari fa'inna. Whatever is below the ankle will burn in the hellfire. Jo bhi takhlo ke niche hoga, wo jahannam ki aag mein jalega. Allah ko kapda jalane se kya maqsad hai? What does Allah Ta'ala mean? There's no need for Allah to burn the cloth. The reality is, Allah is going to burn the person who is wearing that cloth. Allah protect us. Aaj kal log kehte hain, Mujhe sab mere dil mein to takabbur nahi. I wear garment. Shaykh, I don't have no arrogance. I have tawadu. I am humble. Man tawadu'a lillah, rafa'ahu. Whosoever will humble us, Allah will raise that person. Wa man takabbur, wada'ahu. Whosoever will have arrogance, Allah will destroy that person. I don't have arrogance. I leave my trousers below the ankles, you get the trousers, you know, and they're walking the jeans underneath the shoes, so, yeah? And it's a sign, they're walking in that way. Ajeeb. Whatever state, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never ever wore a garment under his ankles. He never possessed even an iota of the comfort of Allah. Even in his speeches, he used to mention, أَنَا سَيِّدُ مُلْدِ عَادَمَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَلَقَهُ. I will be the leader of Ibn Adam on the day of judgment. But I have no aqqa, I'm not proud of it. This is the ni'mah which Allah has given me. I am mentioning a favor, tahdees bin ni'mah. I will be the ones who will raise the flag of Hamd on the day of Qiyamah, and I am the fakhr. I will be the one who will enter into paradise first, wala faqar, and I have no arrogance, and I am not boasting about it. This was the ni'mah, the hadith bin ni'mah, mentioning the favors. Rasulullah SAW never wore his garments below his ankles. In today's day and age, we want to justify that I don't have arrogance, so I can wear it. Whether it's a jubba, whether it's our trousers, some people say, Shaykh, I'm sorry, but my stomach goes up. Yeah. But make it lower than you know, take it in. Yeah. Diet, man. Yeah? Why I'm in a bloated stomach for, yeah? Who diet? It's a mujit kooch takabur ni. Bas kya karu mera pain itna bula hua hai. So bas mo chala jata hai nicha, samjhe? Just hope it doesn't happen like that, man. That you underwear can be seen. Allah protect you. Yeah? Ajeeb Allah. So wallahi, we need to understand the beautiful sayings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We need to adopt and choose the way of righteousness, inshallah. See, inshallah, yeah? we will try and follow the Sunnah of Rasulullah, and we will make sure that we are not from those whose intellect is taken away. The first step of being ignorant is takabbur. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that these people, سبيل الغي يتخذون سبيلا ذلك بأنهم كذبوا بآياتنا. This is why. Why did they have this situation? Why did they adopt the wrong path? Why did they go on the path of shaitan? Because they rejected and they denied our signs. They denied the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ذلك بأنهم كذبوا بآياتنا وكانوا عنها غافلين. And they were heedless in regards to the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. والذين كذبوا بآياتنا ولقاء الآخرة. Those who reject and deny the signs of Allah and meeting Allah on the Day of Judgment, the Yawm al-Akhirah, habitat a'maluhum, their actions will be wasted. They will be in total loss. They will be in vain. Habitat a'maluhum, habitat sawa, illa ma kan ya'malun. Allah poses a question. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so should they be rewarded with anything except what they have done? Allah. They'll only be rewarded with what they've done. If they've done what they've done in this dunya, they followed the sabir al-ghay, they followed the path of wickedness, they followed the path of shaitan, then they will have to face the consequence of being from the hizb al-shaitan on the Day of Judgment. Allah protect us and save us, inshallah. But if we strive, if we try, if we struggle, occasions will come and we will make mistakes. But again, ask tawbah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At-ta'ibu min al-dhanbi kama la dhanba lahu. The one who repents from his sin, as though he commits no sin. Allah has given us this door of forgiveness to ask from Allah's treasures, to ask Him after we make a mistake, and we make a firm resolution. Insha'Allah, I will try and follow the sunnah of our Habib, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the best of my ability. If I am overpowered by my nafs, by the tricks of shaitan, then I will straight away, immediately again, repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I will repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I will come back onto the straight path, inshallah. If we make these firm intentions, inshallah, thumma inshallah, thumma inshallah, whatever we have said or whatever we have heard will be of benefit to us, inshallah. But if we just spend our time here, as Hazrat Muawiyah said, initially, if we sit with the intention, oh, what a good speech, Allah protect me, ameen, al-qul, ameen, or this and that and the other, but it's, if we don't take anything back from this, and I am, first and foremost, I am more in need of hidayah and guidance than you are. So you make dua for me first, inshallah, eh? That Allah keeps me on guidance, inshallah, eh? Allah keeps me on sirat al-mustaqim, inshallah, Allah keeps me on the path of the guiding ones, inshallah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also keeps you all, the listeners, onto the path of Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, and especially on the path of Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To conclude, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, man ahabba sunnati faqad ahabbani. Whosoever will love my ways has in reality loved me. And whosoever will love Rasulullah, man ahabbani kana ma'ya fil jannah. Subhanallah. What do we ask everyone? Do you want to be with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Yes or no? Or do you want to be with Beckham? Do you want to be with Ronaldo? Do you want to be with Madonna's and the Madonna's of today? And the Kabab and the Kabana of today? No. We don't want to be with any of these people. Because success for us is that we are in our graves. We will be the ones who have to give an answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we want the malaika in the grave that when they ask us the question, we say, my way of life was none but Islam. Of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I think the microphone or the transmit system has given up on me now, saying enough, man, take it easy, good. So maybe it's saying enough is enough. Enough is enough? Yeah, mashallah, see that? It's time to enjoy food now, inshallah, if they prepare anything. Inshallah. Who's going to stay over for food? Everything's for me then, inshallah. Nobody's going to stay always. Anyway, to conclude, brothers, Rasulullah says in this beautiful hadith, man ahabbani kana ma'iya fil jannah. Whosoever will love me will be with me
on the day of Qiyamah, inshaAllah.
We hope we will be with Rasulullah on the day of Judgment. And if we hold on to the Sunnah of Rasulullah, an Anas al-Abi Hurairah, man tamassaka bi sunnati inda fasadi ummati, like we mentioned, all these evils and all these forces and all these challenges around us today, all the turbulence that is around us, if we and hold on to the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we will get the reward of 100 shaheeds, subhanAllah. 100 martyrs. And what is the reward of one martyr? Before the blood of that martyr reaches the ground, Allah forgives all his sins, subhanAllah. Yeah? This is sacrifice. This is the way we have to make sure. مَنْ جَاهَدَ نَفْسَهُ فِي طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ. This is the true mujahid. This is the true person who is sacrificing his nafs, desires, for the sake of pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah ta'ala make us true mujahids and warriors for the sake of his deen, inshaAllah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who act on the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us to save ourselves and protect ourselves from the evils of our heart, from the tricks of shaitan. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. May he give us all the tawfiq, act upon what has been said and heard. And may he make us all true Muslims, inshallah. May he make us from those who are the flag bearers of Islam. May he make us the ambassadors of the true sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May he save me and yourselves to be from those who becomes a means of shame and blame to Islam. May he make us from those who become a means of a person coming into the fold of Islam. Ameen. يا رب العالمين وما علينا إلا البلاغ وصلى الله على النبي الكريم سبحان الله وبحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك وصلى الله على النبي الكريم وجزاكم الله خيرا أحسن الجزاء في الدارين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله
سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله